Good, good. Let's just get started and just jump straight in. We want to write a set, and for our purposes, we only care about two functions. We want to fill it with random numbers, and then we want to check whether a number is in the set. So we can use stdset, which is a binary tree, to implement that. Our generate function just calls insert, and our contains function just calls find. We can also switch to a hash set by using unordered set. Rest stays the same. Or we could use a vector. We have a vector of data, resize it, fill it with random data, and I've only now realized 2 minutes ago that I didn't handle duplicates here the same way as I did before, so that's a bug, but okay. And then contains is a linear search. Or we can optimize that, sort the data, and then use a binary search. And this is the first time I was actually able to use the binary search algorithm because it just returns a bool whether or not the data is there. And usually you want the position, so you have to use lower bound. But here, binary search is fine. So let's benchmark the sets. We vary, going to vary the size of the set, fill it with random data, and then repeatedly look for a random number. If you went to any data structure class, you know that those are the big O complexities. The hash set is O1, the linear search is, well, linear, and the other ones are binary search, so log n. And if you just went out of a data structure lecture, you probably would rant that those are the results of the benchmark, right? At least I would do so. And actually, this happens. So we can first of all see the blue line, that's the linear search, goes up steeply, but it's not quite straight. There's this little bump here, so that's interesting. But otherwise, we can't really see anything there, so we zoom in. This is the first 1,000 bytes, straight blue linear search, and as you can see, it's actually the fastest one until we've reached around 100 bytes. Whereas the other ones are pretty similar, and the red line, that's the hash set, only becomes the fastest one after 500 bytes. Let's zoom out again, and let's get rid of the blue line so we can actually see something. Green, that's the STD set implementation, which is significantly slower than our yellow sorted set, even though technically the sorted set has more numbers because we're not handling duplicates in that code. But OK. They both seem to look like log n, but again, they have this dense in the data. And on the bottom, we have the hash sets, faster than everything, but it's not quite constant. It also has an increase at the beginning. So that's interesting. Well, my name is Jonathan Müller, and this is writing cache-friendly C++. It's importantly not an in-depth introduction on caches on modern CPUs. This would be a very interesting talk, but I'm not qualified to give that talk. It's also not how to make your code faster with this weird trick, because that's not how it works. There isn't a general set of guidelines, not just one thing you can do. It's also not a how-to data-oriented design. Data-oriented design is often mentioned together with cache-friendly code because it is, by design, a very cache-friendly design. But I'm not only I mentioned it at the end, but mostly talking about other things. So I'm only going to give a short, essential knowledge about caches, general guidelines, and it's more an overview of a very in-depth topic. I'm going to refer to a lot of other things. You can find all the resources and links there, as well as the slides. Don't bother going there now. The website's not live yet. And please ask questions. The room isn't really ideal for that, but please interrupt me if anything is unclear. So let's begin. What every programmer needs to know about memory access. This is a benchmark again. We have a container, fill it with random data, and then we're repeatedly going to increment it. This is what we are essentially measuring here is the size it takes for memory access. And again, we are going to vary the number of bytes in our data, and we are setting the set bytes processed there at the end. This allows us to measure the speed. So we're going to plot the speed now. And you might expect this. We are plotting the size in kilobytes against the speed. Well, speed should stay constant. We're just doing the same thing, just on more and more data. This should all cancel out. But actually, this happens. We have constant speed, then it drops a little bit, then it drops more. And just to clarify, from now on all graphs, higher is better. So we want really high things there. So why does it drop? Well, the reason for that are caches. Main memory access is slow, so instead of going to main memory every time, the CPU caches it. So, for example, at the beginning, we only have the array in the main memory, so in the first iteration, we have to load it from main memory. But as we do so, we store it in the cache. At the end of the first iteration, everything's in the cache. But then, on every other iteration, it's already cached, so the speed is faster. And this is the case until our array doesn't fit into the cache anymore. At that point, we still have to go and access memory on every subsequent iteration. So this is what happens here at the beginning. Until we've reached 16 kilobytes on that machine, the entire array fits into the cache. Then it doesn't, so it becomes slower. Luckily, there's a second cache. It's bigger. On this machine, it's 2 megabytes. So you can see another small drop after 2 megabytes, because then it doesn't fit there anymore. Luckily, there's this third cache. Again, constant, a bit slower speed until we've reached 8 megabytes. And at this point, the array doesn't fit into the cache anymore at all. So we have to go to main memory. This happens with the last 2 ones. Everything clear so far? Good. So the takeaway is main memory access is slow, so we're going to caching use memory. And there are multiple levels of caches with varying sizes and access speed, and sadly, the fast caches are also the slowest. So let's change the benchmark a little bit. We're keeping the size fixed, and we're going to be using a very huge size, so the array doesn't fit into the cache anymore. And instead of incrementing everything, we're only going to increment every stride elements. And this is what we're going to vary, the number of strides. And important, when we say set bytes processed, we're only going to be counting the bytes as processed that we actually incremented it, so we divide it by the stride. And, well, it doesn't fit into the cache anymore, so same access speed all across, green line at the top. But actually, this happens. It degrades and is then constant only after a given amount. And the reason for that is, again, very simple. Instead of caching single bytes, the CPU caches whole cache lines, so multiple bytes at once. So for example, suppose the cache line is 32 bytes, and our stride is 4, meaning we're accessing every 4-byte integer. That way, when we access one, the CPU loads an entire cache line of 32 bytes, but we're using everything of that cache line, so there's no waste. But when we access every other element, we are skipping 50% of the cache line, but we're still needing to access the entire cache line and load it from memory. So this takes the same amount of time as before, we're just processing only 50% of it, so the speed drops. And again, when we only access every third one, we are wasting 70% of our cache, so the speed drops again. And this is why the speed drops. On my machine, the cache line is 64 bytes, so once we've reached a stride of that, we're only going to access one element out of the cache line. And when we go beyond that, we're skipping entire cache lines, so we're doing the same thing. Speed stays constant. So takeaway two, entire cache lines that are accessed, not individual bytes. And this was not shown in the benchmark, but those cache lines always start on specific addresses. So when we have two memory locations that are closer than 64 bytes, they might end up on different cache lines just because the boundary is always between them. Different benchmark, this time we are processing the data in a specific order. Every element has a given successor, and we're jumping through that array in that order. To ignore cache lines, our data elements are now 64 bytes in size, so there's only one in one cache line, so that's ignored. And again, the data is too big to fit into the entire cache. We're going to be processing it with a linear forward fashion, so the successor of every element is the element directly following it. Also backwards, so just iterating backwards, and then finally doing it in a random order. And those are the results. Again, higher is better, so we can see that random is significantly worse. The reason for that, the CPU tries to predict what we're going to need next, and when we're jumping over it in a random order, it has a really hard time. So the CPU tries to predict what we're going to need next. There's temporal locality, which is why caches work. When we need something, we probably need it again in the near future. And there's also spatial locality. When we need this byte, we probably need the neighboring bytes. This is why cache lines usually work so well. But it goes even beyond further. The CPU does cache prefetching, where it preemptively loads memory into our cache, because it guesses that we're probably going to need it. Finally, let's take a look at this fork part of a parallel accumulate. So we have an array of big integers, a big array of integers. Want to accumulate it, do so by subdividing it into multiple smaller ones. Each one is accumulated in a given thread, and the results are written into a shared smaller sum array. To get the final sum, we would then just need to accumulate that smaller array. On the highlighted line, we are just accessing our elements of the sum array. Every thread has a different index, so there is no waste condition here. We're just accumulating it in parallel. So let's benchmark it. We're going to vary the number of threads, do our accumulate, and just ignore the results for now. This is what you might expect: more threads, faster code. This is why we do multithreading. But actually, this happens, which is not quite the why you reuse threads. And the reason for that is some caches are not shared between CPUs. So suppose we have two CPUs that don't share a cache. And I've put here, this is our sum array. Highlighted in green are the elements our CPUs care about. So then the first CPU goes ahead, does an increment. But now it modified a cache line, the same cache line, which is also in the cache of CPU 1. So if in case CPU 1 wants to then access that element, this has to be sent over to CPU 1. Even though in our case, CPU 1 totally doesn't care about that element, but still has to be copied over. This is called false sharing, and in a way, it negates some of the benefits caching brings us, which is why the performance got slower when we added more threads. The fix is quite simple. Instead of accumulating into the shared array directly, we're accumulating into a local variable and then writing that result. And with that, I got the green line I've shown before. So takeaway 4, some caches are not shared between CPUs. And this fault sharing then can create unnecessary slowdown. And with that, we can partially explain what happened in the introduction. Linear set has contiguous memory, so it's very good for cache prefetching. However, we can explain the bumps there. This is just because when the array exceeded the cache size, so it has to go to a bigger cache. This is when the slope changed. Again, sorted set, also contiguous memory, so the binary search is very good for prefetching. Whereas on the other hand, the STD set, it's a binary tree, the nodes are located somewhere in memory, cache prefetching doesn't really work, we have to do pointer chasing, so it was slower. And unordered set does open hashing, which means it's essentially a vector of lists. This explains the relatively high constant factor and also partially the bumps, again, just due to cache sizes. So this is what you need to know about caches. Okay. Let's talk about writing cache-friendly types, because I like types, so let's start with those. Recap. Main memory access is slow, and the fast caches are small. So maybe smaller types use less cache space, make your type smaller, more fit into the cache. But don't just go ahead and use short everywhere. While a short integer is smaller than an int, it's also potentially slower to do arithmetic on. There are different categories of types, like calculation types, which you use in algorithms, and the types you use in functions. Here, we're only going to be looking at storage types for now. Those are the types you store in containers and as member variables. And it may sometimes make sense to make those types smaller. So we're going to play a little game. I'll give you a type, and you tell me how many bits of information does this type have. So in this case, it's a 32-bit integer, so it has 32 bits of information. And what's its size? As returned by sizeof, which is the size in bytes. We're assuming 8-bit bytes here. Okay. So this is B. It has a UN16 and a UN32T. How many bits of information does B have? Just shout. Now, the actual bits of information we care about. What I mean with bits of information in this case is 48. It has a UN16 and a UN32T, so we have 48 bits of information. This is the stuff of the type we actually care about in our types. It has 2 to the power of 48 different observable values. Okay? What's the result of size of? 8. 8 bytes. Why 8 bytes? Yeah, it's architecture specific, but I'm... Okay, assume Linux 64-bit, same compiler. What's the result of size of 8? Why 8? Alignment. This is what the standard says about alignment, but you can't read that, so here are pictures. When the type has an alignment of 1, it can start on every address, so everything highlighted in green here. When the alignment is 2, it means the address must be even, so it can only be on those addresses. Likewise for 4, it can only be on those addresses. So that's alignment. When we have a fundamental type on the sensible modern API, the alignment is usually the same as the size. And when we have a class type, the alignment is the maximum of all members. So when we have B, the alignment is 4 because that's the alignment of a UN32T. Then we can place a B object at the green addresses. We first place the first member because members are laid out in order as they're declared, so the UN16T. Then we can't place the UN32 there because it's not a valid aligned address. Have to leave 2 bytes of padding. Total size is 8. So I might say, okay, no problem. Put it those way, UN32T first, then the UN16, which means the address of the UN16 is always going to be even. No padding between the members. What's the result of size of? 8. Why is it still 8? Yeah, padding, but why padding? Arrays, exactly. When we have an array of T and want to get an element, this is equivalent to doing very simple pointer arithmetic, where we just add a multiple of size of. So size of must be divisible by a line of, otherwise we end up with an underlined address. So in this case, C looks like this, 2 bytes of padding at the end to make it divisible by 4. So in order to get rid of padding, there's a simple algorithm. We can just sort the members by size. Bad has 50% padding just because I placed the members in the worst possible order, whereas good, same members, same amount of information, but they're ordered, no padding. There are also compiler-specific attributes you can look in, but those are potentially dangerous, so you need to know what you're doing there. Okay, let's talk about something else. We have D. D contains a Boolean. How many bits of information does D have? 1, right? It's a Boolean. D can either be true or false. What's the result of size of? 4 people are... Now it's 1. And yeah, just to make it clear, size of is always a whole number greater than 1, so it's not like a 1-bit type. Okay, so we are storing 8 bits to store 1 bit. Okay. We have an enum with 4 different values. How many bits of information do we have here? 2. 2 bits of information. And what's the result of size of? 4. On my machine. Why 4? When we have an enum class, underlying type is int, unless we specify otherwise. Okay, so now we're wasting 30 bits to store 2 bits. We have 64-bit pointers, and we have a pointer to UN32T. How many bits of information? I'm hearing a quiet 64. 48, okay, that's too architecture specific. But it's also not 64. Do I hear anything else? Almost, 62. Why 62? Alignment. When we have a UN32T, it's 4 byte aligned, so the address is always divisible by 4, which means the 2 lower bits are always 0. They are not no extra information. 62 bits. What size of? This is an easy one. 8. It's a pointer, 8 bits. Okay, so now we're wasting 2 bits, and you might ask yourself at this point, I mean, who cares really, right? Well, what about this type? A pointer and a Boolean. How many bits of information? 63. We've got our 62-bit pointer and one extra bit. What's the result of size of? 16. It's not even 9, it's 16. We're having added 8 extra bytes just to store 1 additional bit. And I think that's too wasteful. So there are two problems. Some types only have a couple of bits, but they require whole bytes. And there are some types that are forced to waste bits. Bit fields are one solution. When we have a bit field, we can just say this is an arbitrarily sized integer. So for our enum, we only need 2 bits. For our boolean, we only need 1. And for our integer in the range 0 to 23, we only need 5 bits. In this case, it just so happens that we have 1 byte for 8 bits. Bit fields aren't the best feature, however. We can't directly assign our enum because it's not an integer. We can overflow the implicit range, and if we can even overflow the integer range completely because it's unsigned, everything's well formed there. So I wrote, also, technically, compilers don't actually need to pack bit fields together. They could just have separate integer types, but no compiler does that, but still, they could. So I wrote a library, Tiny. It's a low-level library for minimizing the size of your types. And it tackles both problems at once. It's built around those tiny types. A tiny type is a type that only needs a couple of bits. Looks interface of a tiny type, it's a concept, looks like so. So we've got our object type, this is the type the tiny type models, then we say how many bits we need, and then this proxy. It takes a bit view, which just views the bits where it's stored, and acts like a reference to the object type. So for example, this is a tiny bool, object type is bool, we need 1 bit, and then we just put or extract the bits in order to load and store a boolean. Clear that concept? So in a similar way, I've also written tiny integers, tiny enums, and tiny flexset, which is a collection of multiple enums. Then we can write our destruct again. We're using tiny storage. It stores multiple tiny types in a compact way. Same behavior, 1 bit. The interface is a little bit, we don't have like named members have to go by index, but you can always have like member functions. But now everything works. We can assign our enum, we get an assertion failure when we overflow, etc. Suppose you have a type that has padding. We can use tiny padding storage, specify the type of padding, and then store multiple tiny types in the padding of that type, very compact way. You have to tell tiny, also in the previous example, you had to tell tiny like how big the enum is. You can either do that inline by adding a special member or specialize some traits. There's also a horrible hack that won me an iPad, but I'm not going to be talking about that one. So, and again, with the tiny padding storage, when you have a type of padding, you have to specialize some traits, simply list all the members, it will calculate the padding for you. And likewise, we have tiny pointer storage, it allows storing tiny boolean inside the alignment bits of a pointer. This is very similar to the LLVM pointer in pair. I don't know whether you're familiar. Library also has a couple of other features, like tombstones, which are just special values you can use to mark an empty optional without having an extra boolean, for example. I plan on doing things like NAND packing, and there are also some helpers. Recommend checking it out after the talk. So remember, main memory access is slow, and predictable access patterns are better cached. So you might think, OK, let's just avoid pointers. And there are some situations where this is valuable, for example, here. We've got the classical Java-based OOP hierarchy of shapes, and then we have a button, which is a label and a unique pointer. When we want to access the shape, we have an indirection. This can lead to cache misses, so it's bad. But when we know that the inheritance hierarchy is closed, we can use a variant instead, store it inline, no indirection there. So when you have this situation, consider replacing unique pointer with a standard variant. On the other hand, when we have, for example, named data, it has a name and then lots and lots of data, where data is really big. And now we want to find the data with a specific name. We use findIf here. This is not ideal, because this is how the memory layout looks. We have a string, then lots of data, then another string, then more data. And the findIf call only cares about the green parts. But still, everything has to be loaded into the cache line, so we're again wasting space in our cache line. This can be slower. If we have this data is really big, we can consider replacing it with a pointer to data, where the actual data is stored someplace else. Then we only need to waste space in our cache line for the pointer, not the whole data, which can be make the searches a lot faster. So consider replacing big objects with pointers to heap allocated objects. Again, depends on the situation, what your usage requirements are. So let's continue talking about containers. Main memory access is slow. There's a common theme in this presentation. And cache prefetching works best for predictable linear memory access. So we should use containers that have contiguous memory, no pointer chasing. So don't use types like std::list or std::set. Or as Tony put it, when choosing a container, remember vector is best. Leave a comment to explain if you choose from the rest. So why is vector best? This is how vector looks. If you ignore allocators and stuff, it's three pointers. You've all seen diagrams like this. We've got our beginning, one past the end, and then one past the allocated memory. So size, the difference between end and begin, and capacity is end alloc minus begin. Then we can increase the capacity by calling reserve, allocates new memory, relocates the existing elements there, deallocates the old one. When you have exceptions, it's a bit more complicated than that, but wouldn't fit on the slide. So that's reserve. We can add element with pushback. We just need to increase the capacity if necessary by some amount. Then construct the new object at the end. To insert at a specific position, we can do it very elegantly, Sean Perl style. So we've got our array. Want to insert at this position, do a pushback, and then do a rotate. The rotor just moves that range over, and the new one is at the correct position. This is not the most efficient one, but it's a one-liner, so good for slides. And in case you're wondering about the double columns at the placement new and the static cast, those are technically necessary, but because C++, but yeah. Removing things is even simpler. Just call the destructor and do a pointer decrement. There's no need to deallocate memory now. And arrays, gently, just move everything over, and then remove the moved from last one. Pretty straightforward container. So how can it be used? Suppose we have a collection of elements. We care about the order or need to access them by index. And we have rare insertions or arrays in the middle. Traditionally, you would use standard vector because that's what it's designed for. And it's cache-friendly, so that's also the cache-friendly solution. But now suppose we want frequent insertions at frequent insertions or arrays of specific elements. Traditionally, you would use standard list because arrays of a specific element is O1, but this is not cache-friendly. What can we do in a cache-friendly container? DAG, I hear DAG. Yeah, we can. There's a trick. Note that order is not important. So we can use std::vector with what I call a bag interface. Looks like so. We have our container using a vector internally. Insert just does a pushback because order is not important. And then erase just overwrites the element we are erasing with the last one and then does a popback. This is always O1 and very fast. But what happens when we want to erase the last element? We are then doing a self-move. Who would think this might be a problem? OK, a few. I did a bit of research, and I think the current consensus is that a self-move might not be a no-op, but it also shouldn't crash your program. And as we are destroying the last element then immediately afterwards, we don't actually care what self-move does, so it's probably fine. Maybe a standard library implementation can do that, but your implementation probably certainly can. OK, now again, order is still not important, but now we want to look up. Traditionally, this is where we use stat or set or unordered set. But unordered set is a vector of lists, so that's not really cache-friendly. What's a cache-friendly solution? The answers are either use vector. In this case, we're going to use a vector with a set interface. So, for example, we've already seen linear set. Just do a pushback, potentially prevent duplicates, and then find just does a linear search. This is a very simple implementation. As we've seen, it's fast when we only have a couple of elements. Then nothing beats that. When we just have four elements, this is as fast as we get. We can also do a sorted set, or as it's commonly called a flat set. We just insert, keeping everything sorted, and then do a binary search. Already seen that as well. And this is faster from a big O complexity, but it requires that your types provide some ordering, which might not be possible for all types. And we can also write a hash set in just that manner. Just use a vector and then closed hashing on top of that, but this wouldn't fit on the slide, so I'm just going to refer you to those other talks. It's a lot more complicated, links also at the end. But again, a hash set, it requires a hash algorithm for your type, so it might not be the most general solution. We again have a collection, we don't care about order, but now we want to look up them by some external property. This is where we use map or unordered map. What's a more cache-friendly solution? Vector. Yeah, you see, it's very easy. We use a vector, and this time we use a set vector, and pair it with a vector of values. So it looks like this. We have a set of keys, and then our vector of values, and when we want to access a key, value from a key, we search for the key, then transform that to, and then access the value at the same index. So keys and values are implicitly linked by sharing a common index. Why have I chosen that approach and just not use a sorted set of a pair of key and value? Would like look like so. This is the memory layout. We have the keys and we have the values, and we want to do a lookup. We only care about the green parts. Again, the value is just waste. But then when we do a lookup, has to load cache lines, the values are still in the cache lines, we're wasting cache space. Not good. But when we have them separately, everything's tightly packed together, no waste in our cache line. Because when we do lookup, we only care about one value, the value of our key. We don't care about any other value. So there's no need to put them in the cache. As you can see, I even was able to fit more keys on the slide here. So that's vector usage, but I've sort of glossed about two important things before. How are we actually going to allocate memory in reserve? And what's the new capacity once we do a pushback? Those are non-trivial questions, which highly depend, and there are many different solutions. So a library author does what they always do. They push that solution back to the user by providing customization points. To customize the allocation, we have an allocator, which is the C++ sweet spot of being both too complicated and a bit lacking. So there are replacements like polymorphic memory resources. And in my first ever conference talk 2 years ago, on the same date actually, I presented a different approach. You can watch that if you like. We cannot really customize the growth of the std vector, which is a bit unfortunate. So maybe we should just go ahead and have a new policy, the growth policy. But this is not ideal because allocator and growth policy are tightly coupled. You might have a specific allocator that's really good for a certain growth policy. So you wouldn't want to have to separate that decision. And also, sometimes you have an allocator that can resize in place. So there's no reserve can be done completely differently. You might want to support that. So we need a different level of customization point here. Now keep that in mind, I'm talking about something else. What, in some cases, we have a vector and we only often have a small number of elements, like 4. Then it would be wasteful to do a heap allocation for 4 elements. Instead, we can just store them in line in a static allocated memory member array and only use a dynamic allocation once we exceed 4 elements. This is often the case with std string, where we come there. Chandler gave a great talk about implementing the small kinds of small buffer optimization because, again, it's not possible with std vector. So I bought a library, array. It provides arrays because I'm great at naming. And it basically has all the containers we have before. So array is the std vector. We've got our bag, the flat set, the flat map, etc. I didn't implement hash tables because that's just too complicated. Use a specialized library for that. The new customization point I've chosen is a block storage. This is only cares about the capacity memory. It does not care about the elements constructed inside our vector. So when we do reserve, we have to like pass it how many additional bytes do we need, and then we have to pass it the view where the elements are constructed. Those then need to be copied over to the new location. The full concept is a bit more complicated because of performance and C++ reasons, but luckily for the common case, you don't need to write any block storage. You can just use one of the 3 I've provided. Block storage embedded just uses statically sized buffer, can't grow beyond that. With that, you have a vector where the capacity is fixed, but the size can vary, which is not a C array, there the size is also fixed. heap does the trivial thing, allocator and growth policy, except the allocator is called heap because it's a different simplified concept. This works for the general case. And then SBO uses a small-sized buffer and then uses the big block storage. Again, array, check it out after the talk. Now, at this point of the talk, I haven't told you everything you needed to know about caches. And this is a pretty common theme with cache-friendly talks, sadly. There's one important fact you need to realize. Code is memory, too. And it makes sense. Our program code actually has to be stored somewhere. But we usually don't think about it. So here's an incorrect but useful mental model. Our program is an array of instructions, and then the CPU starts executing the first one, and every instruction knows its successor. This is a lot similar to the data benchmark earlier, where every data element had a given successor. And we've seen what happens when we do a random order in those. So keep that, Again, instructions have to be fetched somewhere, have to be stored somewhere, memory access is slow, so there are caches for instructions as well. Which means they have the same caching behavior as data. There are cache lines, there's cache prefetching. So it makes sense to talk about cache-friendly code itself. And the best case, again, is linear simple code. We don't have branches, we don't have function calls, especially no virtuals or function pointers, because there statically it isn't known anything where they might jump. And no jump instruction itself. Then we just have linear execution, as we've seen, very easy to predict, very easy to do prefetching there. But of course, we can't write any non-trivial program without branches. So that's not an option. But when you have like a specialized algorithm, try to avoid branches inside that loop, for example. And there's a lot of black magic going on with cache-friendly code. So here we are processing random data. Again, huge container filled with random data. We want to accumulate everything, but when it's zero, we are going to do 64 separate instructions. So this just simulates a lot of code there. So when D is zero, we do a lot of code. And D is rarely zero. It's random data, so the chance of D being zero is very low. We could write it like so. We do the increment, then we handle the special case. Or we could write it like so. We do the increment. Handle the special case, then we do the increment. So let's benchmark both versions. Looks like so, I have our random data, I've added at least one zero there, then we're benchmarking it. Who thinks there's a difference between, who thinks there's no difference between the two versions? Okay, one person. Who thinks this one is faster, where we first do the count and then we handle the special case? Okay, a couple. Who thinks this version is faster? We do the special case, then we do the increment. Less than before. Who has no idea and is just waiting for me to show you? Okay, everyone else. For the record, when I wrote that benchmark, I thought this one's faster. So those are the results. When we do the increment last, we are significantly faster. We are twice as fast. And I was like, so, what's going on here? This is a nice diagram of our code. By the way, I've written a custom LaTeX theme for this talk because I didn't actually want to start the slides, so I really like that. Anyways, custom LaTeX diagram. We first do the initialize, then we update the count, then we handle zero, and then we do the loop increment, go to the next element, check for the exit condition, and if not, jump back. And on the right, it's just swapped. First we do the handle zero, then we update the count. This is how the cache lines look. Handle zero is a lot of instructions, which means that on the left version, update count and the loop exit code is not in the same cache line, whereas on the right side, it does. And it just so happens that because handle zero is rarely executed and because of other caching behavior, on my machine, that is twice as fast. I can't really give you any more reason why. I don't think it should be twice as fast, but you can help me look at the benchmark later. So what we can learn, however, is that we put hot code that's executed a lot closely together with other hot code. We can rearrange branches. So in this case, the loop exit code is hot, and the increment was hot, so we should put them closely together by doing the increment at the end. We should avoid function pointers and virtual calls in hot code because they would jump anywhere, which is probably not cached. We have cache misses, and it's slower. And there are also attributes. Hot cold can be used to mark functions as hot cold, and for C++20 we've got likely and unlikely. There we can mark individual statements as being likely or unlikely executed. But this gets even weirder. I didn't come up with this benchmark, the link there at the end. So again, benchmarking an array increment got 20 gigabytes per second on my machine. And there's this foo function at the top, it's not really used, so we comment it out, and the performance drops to 15 gigabytes per second. Don't comment your code. So what the author couldn't explain it completely either, but what happens here is the instructions are stored, the two functions are stored contiguously in memory, and when the first one's there, the offsets are different, the cache line boundaries are different, so it's slower. And as Simon said on Twitter, he once added three nodes to a function, and it's better by an order of magnitude. Simply because the three knob instructions moved the cache line boundaries of the hot data, which made it a lot faster. So if you can have a really good instinct, consider the alignment of the code by just guessing, I think, those things. There are also compiler flags to align functions on specific addresses, but I can't really. So consider alignment of your code. Everything I've shown you so far was... Any questions so far? Just because... Okay. I'm always going a lot faster than when I practice. I have plenty of time left, and previously I couldn't fit it into 1 hour, so that's always the magic here. I'm going to drink something. So, every technique I've shown you so far can be done locally. Just swap one container implementation, optimize the members of your types differently. But we can also do whole program changes to make it more cache-friendly. Remember, main memory access is slow. And cache lines are cached, not individual bytes. Spatial locality. So we should group data that will be accessed together actually in the same place. You might think, okay, that's obvious. But with object-oriented design, we've learned to structure the program based on real-world entities. So for example, a shape again. Every shape has a color, it can be visible, and we want to draw it and calculate its area. So we have base class, virtual functions, common properties there. And then we have our circle, inheriting from it. Implement draw, but only if it's actually visible. Calculate the area and store point-specific information like a center and a radius. We can also do square, looks the same, just storing different information and having a different implementation. And then we have a vector of unique pointer to shapes, iterating over it and drawing it, and calculating the total area, iterating over it, drawing it. Pretty textbook OOP stuff. But it's not ideal. There's a cache-unfriendly indirection because of the unique pointer. We're wasting cache line space because we are storing an is-visible Boolean flag, which is at least 1 byte, probably more due to alignment. So we're wasting space in our cache line. There are function pointers inside the hop loop due to the virtual calls, and we actually need to process invisible entities as well. We're calling draw on everything, even if they're not visible. And this is where data-oriented design helps. Here we can structure the program by looking at the flow of data. How many of you went to the data-oriented design talk yesterday? Okay, I guess so. So, might be a bit of repetition here, sorry about that. So, let's take a look back. What are we actually trying to do here? We want to draw shapes, and we want to calculate the total area of all shapes. Well, what do we need for that? To draw them, we need their color and the geometry information, like position and size. And to calculate the area, we just need the geometry information. So, let's just store the geometry information for now. We have the geometry information for a circle, geometry information for a square. Store them tightly together, store them in two separate arrays in a shaped geometry. Now, every geometry information is stored there. Then we can calculate the total area. We write a single function that takes every shape because we want to do the total area and not the specific area of a single shape. So we're just iterating first over our circles, then over our square, adding the results, returning it. This is very straightforward code. There are no branches there, no indirections, no wasted cache lines. Well, a bit of wasted cache line space, because we're storing the position in our geometry information as well, even though we don't need it for area. We could go further and remove that, but I didn't bother with that here. So almost no wasted cache space, and it's very cache-friendly code. To render them, we can't do the same trick of sorting them by type, because we need to draw them in a specific order to make overlapping entities work correctly. So we're storing a vector of pairs of shape ID and color, where the shape ID uniquely identifies the geometry information. We have its kind, which determines in which vector they are, and the index is then the index in that vector. Then we store them, but only the visible ones. Don't need to store the other ones. Then our draw function takes everything, iterating over it, only the visible ones. Have to do a branch here, but otherwise, it's still pretty straightforward. There are no indirect calls. We're not wasting anything, not drawing invisible entities. Very streamlined code. So you should group data based on how it's actually going to be used, not just based on some real-world logical entity concept. We should implement the common task, not the special one. For example, when we have an area function of every shape, this is the special case where we just have a single shape. But we don't have a single shape, we have an array of shapes. So we should just write a function that takes an array of shapes and calculates the total area. That way it fits nicely into the cache, we do it in one place, etc. And we should eliminate Booleans and object states by making them implicit. If you have a Boolean in your type, you're wasting at least one byte of your cache line, potentially more due to alignment. And we can eliminate them by having different containers for the visible and invisible entities and things like that, by making it implicit in the control flow. That way, we can also eliminate branches in our algorithm, which is also more cache-friendly code. We can even go one step further and change our shapes render struct. Now we're having a separate container of shape kinds, separate container of indices, and a separate container of colors. Why would we want to do that? Answer again is, if we do this approach, there's absolutely no padding. The previous one, there had to be padding because the types could potentially be different sizes. We are wasting space. But here, it's an array. There's no padding in those types. So it's, again, no wasted cache space. And this is the array of structs with a struct of arrays approach. Traditionally, in OOP, you have an entity, which is a struct, and you store multiple of them in an array. But what's a lot more CPU-friendly is when you have a struct containing arrays of the different members. This enables SIMD instructions when we like dealing with floating points. It's also very easy when we only want to access a subset of the members. We can only iterate over the containers we need and don't need to load anything else into our cache line. So consider a structure of array approach in your program. However, it's inconvenient. C++ and C, they're built around of arrays or structs. That this is what's nice in that language. This approach is a lot more inconvenient, so it's a trade-off you have to make. In my array library, I also have a container called variant-bag. This is a lot like the shapes geometry class. It takes multiple types, has a separate bag for each of those types. And I plan on doing the opposite, a tuple bag. This takes multiple types, again, has a container for the separate types, but it's more like shapes render. The three containers will always have the same size, and they're implicitly linked together by sharing a common index. But I haven't found time to implement that yet. Mike Acton gave a keynote at CPPCon about data-oriented design, which it's a really great one, you should watch it. And there's also a free ebook at data-oriented design, again, all links in the resource. So with that, let's recap. Main memory access is slow. So we should improve locality of our data. We should use simple, contiguous memory layouts. That way, it is much better for the cache. We shouldn't waste cache space. We should group data based on the access pattern so we're not loading unnecessary things. This group data based on access patterns also what I did with the set, where we have like a separate set of keys and the values in different locations, so we're not accessing values when we only care about keys. And don't forget about the instruction cache. The simplest one you can do is put the cold code, like logging and error handling, away from the hot code. This can make a big difference. But there is a much more important takeaway. use benchmarks and profiling data. You could go ahead and rewrite your entire library using tiny types, but you probably have less performance because they are a bit more costly to access. It's just not a simple load, has to do a bit of bit shifting and things like that. So you should benchmark optimizations. And every benchmark I've shown you in this presentation is completely useless. I've just picked a single data point, not multiple ones, tweaked them until I got the results I wanted, because I wanted to demonstrate caching behavior, so I got the graphs first and wrote the benchmarks accordingly. And in general, micro-benchmarks have this weird instruction cache behavior. You've seen, you uncomment a completely random function, remove it, suddenly performance differences. Or you have like a different setup. So micro-benchmarks in general are not really good. It's best when you have like a single metric for your application that you can optimize for. Like when you have a game, you can optimize for frame rates, things like that. Single global metric, do all optimizations based on that. So that was my talk. Again, this is the link to where you will find all the resources and slides once I put them online. If you follow me on Twitter, I'll tweet that out, so no need to poll frequently. And if you like what I'm doing and want to support me in making even more libraries, I have too many already, consider checking out my Patreons. This would also enable me to get a machine that has a bit bigger caches. When you Google for caching benchmark, usually the cache sizes are a bit bigger than on my machine, but yeah. So that was my talk. Thank you very much for listening. Now, are there any questions or criticism of my benchmarks? I can also run them for you if you want anything. Okay. Yeah, I guess then. I'm going to go now. So. No, it's okay. Go ahead.
I got one. maybe one question. So when you do all the benchmarks, so how much do you think does profile-guided optimization help you?
Profile-guided optimization is really good because it like determines which code is going to be hot and which one isn't. It can optimize branches accordingly. So when you have like this profile-guided optimization bundled over the process example, I haven't tested it, but it should probably figure out like that the is cold and rearrange the branches accordingly. It's definitely worthwhile.
Yeah. That was my guess. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
I think it was like slide 28 or something, where you said that there is like a cached prefetcher.
Yeah.
Which is actually going to prefetch from main memory.
Yeah.
Does it mean that if you're going to access elements which are not in cache, but in some order, it's going to be faster than random access?
I did get the last part. Faster than?
Faster than the random access.
Yes, it's when you have a predictable access pattern, it's going to be faster.
Have a measurement here? Did you try that?
I tried what exactly?
To compare if we have random access
or
some predictable but not in cache access. So which we are going to try like every time to have a cache miss.
Yeah.
But if I understood well, then this cache prefetcher should figure that out and prefetch it before.
Yeah.
And then we will have better performance than if we access it random. Am I right?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
There are also tangentially related, there are also compiler-specific instructions to manually prefetch some data. So if you know what you're doing and you usually don't, you can insert those and manually prefetch things before you reach them. So like in a loop iteration, prefetch the data for the 10 loop iteration 10 steps from now, for example.
OK, thank you.
Yeah.